What a pleasure to be here. Thank you. I recognize some faces in the room here, not just from my lab, but people who have asked me very incisive questions before. So thanks for coming back, and I hope I can answer more questions this time. The reason we can talk about innovation here in San Diego so easily is because we have incredibly hardworking members of our community, and we don't think of industry versus academia. We're all part of the same team. So it's talent, tenacity, teamwork is what we talk about in anything that I'm involved in, because I really think we have to work together to innovate, which means to take a discovery and actually make something out of it. Because we all think we're brilliant when we have those epiphanies in the middle of the night. Why didn't I think about this before? Well, I'm sure a lot of other people thought about it too, but actually doing something useful with that, that's the process of innovation. That's what Donna and Ruben cracked the whip for that we need to do. So there's a sense of urgency here and a lack of nihilism or cynicism that really makes this place very addictive. You can't go anywhere else once you've been here, because this is very fertile ground for making ideas into reality and not just drinking our own Kool-Aid, but having our friends and colleagues say, no, maybe that's not the best approach. Maybe you might want to try something different. And so we bounce ideas off each other fairly regularly, and sometimes very late at night via email, which obviously we can all be reached at. But this is basically how the stem cell field started. It was Tilla McCullough, and I'm originally from Canada, so I always have to do a plug for Canada in every talk. So Tilla McCullough worked in Canada at the time where everybody was worried that there would be a nuclear attack. And so really they were working in their labs on how do you prevent the bone marrow from radiation injury, from just being destroyed. So they started to say, can you take bone marrow from one mouse and put it into a lethally irradiated mouse that would have had atomic bomb blast equivalent dosing with radiation? And so they did that, and so they described stem cells in 1961. So of course this was a long time ago, they were way ahead of their time, and basically what they said is that you could take just a few cells from one mouse, from the bone marrow, transplant them into a lethally irradiated mouse and reconstitute the entire blood-forming system. So that made them think, okay, there are these seeds for bone marrow formation. They call them hematopoietic stem cells, or HSC for short. And then they said these have to have very specific properties. They have to be self-renewing, meaning they can divide without differentiating. So that's the process of cloning, so they can clone themselves. They can home to the bone marrow or other sites that actually allow bone marrow formation to occur. So that process of homing and retention in a bone marrow home or niche is really important for stem cells. They can differentiate, so make different cell types. And they become dormant in environments they like. They go to sleep. And our stem cells are supposed to be asleep quite a lot of the time during our lifespan, because our hematopoietic stem cells are supposed to last our lifespan. They only have 5 self-renewing divisions. There was one person who's across the street who's the president of the SOC, who was one of the first people to suggest that, and that was Elizabeth Blackburn, and she won the Nobel Prize just a few years ago for her discovery of telomerase. At the time, it was sort of heretical that our stem cells would have a clock. She said, of course they have a clock. Why wouldn't they? It's an alarm clock, though, and we don't want our chromosomes to unravel by having telomerase not be regulated properly. That's something she's devoted her career to, but also reminded us that what goes on internally in these stem cells at the molecular level, at the DNA level, the RNA level, and the protein level really matters. But before we could get there, people had to do a lot of work. So first of all, Tilla McCullough had to discover stem cells as a unit. Then Donald Thomas in Seattle had to say, yes, we can do something with stem cells. So he started saying, you know, people who have acute leukemia have 100% mortality rate. Let's start using the bone marrow from other donors to replace their diseased bone marrow. And of course, that involved a lot of radiation, a lot of chemo. I used to do that. I was a bone marrow transplanter for a little while until I thought, well, maybe we can go back to the lab and figure out a better way for some of these diseases to be treated. So anyway, he got the Nobel Prize for bone marrow transplantation in 1990. But when they started, the mortality rate from bone marrow transplantation was 90%, 90. So you can imagine, that's a really daunting thing for a patient to face. What do you say, 90% in the first year? But the mortality rate from acute leukemia was 100%. Obviously, the bar is a lot higher than that for us now. People do pretty well with targeted therapies, with immunotherapy. So we've got to think about things and fortunately have the tools to do a better job. We've got to file disclosures that have teeth get some of the intellectual property protected, and then think about who's the appropriate group to actually bring that forward to the clinic through an industry sort of partnership. In terms of purifying stem cells based on cell surface markers, Irv Weissman was the first to do that in 1988 with Jerry Spangrud and mice, and 1992 with Chuck Baum, who was actually here at Pfizer up until recently. Anyway, so they discovered what the cell surface markers were, so they knew that they could sort these cells. So they were the first to do that. So E. Donald Thomas won the Nobel Prize. I think Tilla McCullough and Irv had contributed substantially as well to regenerative medicine, and this refers to innovative therapies that enable the body to repair, replace, restore, and regenerate damaged or diseased cells and tissues. So what's the disease that prevents regeneration the most? Anybody know? Yeah, age, exactly. Yeah, that's a disease. I'm trying to think of aging as healthy in some sort of weird way, but cancer. So cancer is the number one cause of death for people under 85 in this country. It superseded heart disease. So that means cancer is impairing our normal regenerative processes and has actually hijacked the processes that stem cells would normally use to self-renew, to become dormant, to home to very specific environments, and to differentiate. So the first person to suggest this, another Canadian, John Dick. So he suggested that there were cancer stem cells at the root of cancers that really were a relatively rare population of cells, but like normal hematopoietic stem cells, they could recapitulate all aspects of the tumor, but obviously a very deranged kind of tissue. So he suggested there were these cancer stem cells that were at the root of cancer, and that you could find these in acute myeloid leukemia, take just a few of these cells that had distinctive cell surface markers, and transplant them into mice. Now, a number of other people started to say, well, if they're there in leukemia, maybe they're there in other tumors. So you can see that these were identified in brain tumors, specifically glioblastoma multiforme by Peter Dirks. And then somebody who's very interested in coming here, and we hope comes here, suggested that maybe these cells are resistant to therapies that target dividing cells, because they're not actually dividing, they're dormant. So our hematopoietic stem cells or blood-forming stem cells are supposed to be asleep or dormant 80% of the time. Well, similarly for cancer stem cells, they go to sleep, they resist radiation, and this is something that Jeremy Rich published a few years ago, but that meant we can't use chemo or radiation to get rid of these cells because they won't notice they're asleep. So it wants me to check all my emails simultaneously. Anyway, so that was a sort of a game changer. Then we realized we had to target these cells slightly differently and look at other cancers as well as having the potential to have these cancer stem cells that propagate metastasis, so spread of the cancer to another site, propagate that aggressive, invasive capacity of colon cancer, brain tumors, and other things. So colon cancer initiating cells were also identified. These cells have been identified in pancreatic cancer more recently by Andy Lowy and Tanish Dorea. They just published that from very nice work they did here collaboratively with Ionis Pharmaceuticals, and that was a Nature paper. So lots of stuff going on outside of the realm of leukemia, but what we started asking is, well, maybe these cells aren't really stem cells per se, they just think they are. So really what we started to look at is, was it the downstream progenitor population, meaning the daughters of the stem cells, that were really misbehaving? So this is like a teenager, like my daughter, who thinks she can drive, and really she can't. And I learned on Saturday, I'm too scared to teach her now. So I've insisted on having lessons for her. But this is basically what happens with these progenitors in some cancers that decide to become quite aggressive, like chronic myeloid leukemia and what's called blast crisis. The progenitors start to co-opt these stem cell properties like self-renewal, but they just can't put the brakes on, like my daughter when she thinks she can. She can't. So this is what we discovered in 2004, and that led to the whole idea that maybe our stem cells acquire mutations, but that's not enough. They really need to acquire a lot of mutations. So that's kind of the good news. So aging is not necessarily a bad thing. It just depends on how deranged is that stem cell. So why does it matter to have a mutation in a stem cell? Because a stem cell will last our life. That's a long-lived cell that can go to sleep and hide. So we have to be able to detect these mutations and other changes at the level of the stem cell, because basically that's where they accumulate. So we wrote this review back in 2008, and I think it still holds true, and in fact, you know, the people that have come up with this idea of clonal hematopoiesis, where we all acquire mutations in our stem cells, are looking at the all-aged individuals. So I think it's really important to start thinking of our mutation pattern. The good news is not all mutations are created equally, and not all lead to cancer. So there are certain oncogenic lesions like BCR-ABL that fuel diseases like chronic myeloid leukemia that are really important. If you see that, that's a disease. As soon as you see it, you treat it. And the reason that's important is we have a pill for that. So, you know, we've got people who range in age from 19 into their 70s that have CML, and we generally treat them with a pill. So that's good. So those are the kinds of advances that happen through innovation. Usually what happens is the stem cells pick up the capacity to survive a little bit more because they overexpress BCL2. They lose the capacity to respond to tumor suppressors, and they live longer because of this gene that Liz Blackburn discovered, telomerase reverse transcriptase, or TERT. They evade adaptive immune responses. So those are T and B cell immune responses, but they also learn to evade macrophages, which are our innate immune response. So those are the garbage trucks for the immune system, and the immune system goes, I don't really see that as foreign. I see that as me, and that's because these cells upregulate the don't eat me signal called CD47. And that's a target that is clearly very important in a lot of cancers. Irv Weissman has actually made an antibody to that and has recently started a company called 47 Inc. to target it. But I think the most vexing problem with cancer stem cells is that they learn to self-renew. They can clone themselves. How do we shut that off? And it turns out that's the toughest target. And that's the one that most of us are going after. And trying to decide how cancer stem cells evolve really starts with understanding how they start from the beginning. So you really have to look at diseases that are chronic, like myeloproliferative neoplasms. So myelo just means bone marrow, M-Y-E-L-O. Proliferative just means you have a lot of cells dividing in the bone marrow. Neoplasm, we finally came to terms with the fact that this is a cancer. For a long time, we'd say disorder, and then we said, actually, some people have a high chance of transforming to acute leukemia within a five-year time frame. So if you have myelofibrosis, which is scarring of the bone marrow, 50% of people go on to get acute leukemia in a five-year time frame. But the bigger problem is a lot of people succumb to infection within 2 years. So what we've been trying to understand is in these disorders where you make too many of one type of cell in the bone marrow, whether it's red cells, as in this person who thought he was fine, he was bright red. He had way too many red cells. He thought he was thinking clearly, and his wife said, no, really, you're not. And he said, oh, I thought it was just you saying that. Anyway, it turned out his hemoglobin was 23, normal's 14 to 16. So he had polycythemia vera. That's his wife's hand there. Sometimes people get too many platelets. They have strokes at an early age, you know, 46. They've lost their livelihood. They've had a stroke because they make too many platelets. The platelets stick together. They cause strokes, heart attacks. Myelofibrosis, scarring of the bone marrow. This can occur because of PVET or even chronic myeloid leukemia and lead to bone marrow formation in weird places like that in the knee. So these are vexing problems. 5 per 100,000 people get these disorders. Why does it matter? Huge healthcare costs for looking after people with PV, ET, myelofibrosis, CML we kind of got a handle on. But the other diseases, not so much, because they can cause bleeding, clotting, and they have a potential to evolve to acute leukemia. So we've been asking for 11 years since I came here, how do these diseases get started and what puts them into warp drive? What makes them think they should transform to acute leukemia? So the search actually started with the discovery of this mutation in a gene called JAK2, and that was called just another kinase, JAK, by Andrew Wilkes when he discovered it in 1989. He'd been spending 5 years trying to clone this gene and thought, oh no, my career's over. Here's this useless gene. I don't think it matters for anything. And it turned out to be one of the most important determinants of what a blood-forming stem cell is going to become. It tells it what to grow up to be. And so then it got a much more lofty title, Janus kinase, because it can do a couple of different things. So he was vindicated. Went on to do very well, of course. But then a number of groups were looking for mutations in JAK2 and found it in 2005. And then it all started to make sense because JAK2 drives red blood cell formation. If you turn that on and you can't turn it off, you have polycythemia vera. So 97.5% of people with polycythemia vera have a mutation in that gene, in JAK2, at that very specific position. We didn't know that till 2005. 50% of people with myelofibrosis have that mutation, and about 40% of people with ET have that mutation. So we're trying to figure out, where does it occur? Well, it occurs in stem cells, and we showed that in 2006. It's transmitted through to the daughter cells, the common myeloid progenitors, granulocyte macrophage progenitors, megakaryocyte erythroid progenitors. So we said, great, so what do you do with that? You know, you tell people in clinic you have the JAK2 mutation. They say, well, why did you tell me? I don't know. You can't do anything about it. Well, that's where this place comes in. So because we have a strong sense of community here, we had a local philanthropist, actually a couple of local philanthropists that said, we want you to get to the bottom of this problem. And not just because we think it's important for patients, but because we're intellectually interested. So this is a community where everybody thinks they're a scientist. Everybody thinks they can ask why that happens. So this is great, of course. So we started to look into whether you could selectively inhibit JAK2. And there were many companies around the world, actually, but Ida DeChaite, who's our Director of Industry Relations for the Cancer Center and has also helped us a lot in the Alpha Clinic, said, there's a company down the street that has a pretty selective JAK2 inhibitor, and they've got free food, and actually free wine, and they're having an open house. So off we went, and that was it. That was the beginning of this collaboration with this local company. And they had a JAK2 inhibitor. We shared information. We helped to fund some of these studies. They helped to fund some of these studies. And what we decided is, could we tag the stem cells with a firefly luciferase gene, you know, that makes fireflies glow, and then put them in a mouse that has no immune system and see if we get what's called engraftment using this IVUS in vivo imaging system. This was given to us by John and Rebecca Moores, just because they thought we needed it. So that was kind of cool. So this led to us being able to see normal stem cells when we've transplanted them into a mouse compared to the polycythemia vera counterpart in the downstream daughter cells, or progenitors as they're called. And then we started to say, can we see this by fluorescence-activated cell sorting? When we transplant normal stem cells, do they give rise to red cells? Not as much as polycythemia vera stem and progenitor cells. So then we started to say, hey, this is an assay, this is an experimental design where we can actually test drugs, not just in a tissue culture dish, which often fails to recapitulate what we see in people, but in these humanized mice. So we started working to say, can we target that propensity to make too many red cells in a mouse? And yes, we could. We could see it by IVUS imaging and by FACS. So that led to clinical trials within a year of starting this collaboration. That's because everybody pitched in. Our lab worked like fiends. The people at the local company worked really hard. That was Targagen. We did a large clinical trial here because our physicians were really excited about this trial. Our patients were really invested in it. And man, did they stick with the program. They stuck with the program for 5 years. That's amazing. So anyway, we could see this drug had an impact, not just on the spleen, which can get pretty big, but also on bone marrow fibrosis. So that means it was reducing scarring. The problem was that basically about 3 people around the world developed what's called Wernicke's encephalopathy, which is a weird kind of brain swelling. And so what we learned with these single-agent inhibitors is sometimes they can have long-term side effects that you can never predict in a mouse. So we have to keep our eyes and ears open. This one we're trying to get off clinical hold right now, but it's just the idea that you really have to be very careful when you're doing clinical trials to watch for weird, unexpected things. So it means that you have to be part of the community and have people who are actually undergoing the trial be able to ask questions. Is it normal to be dizzy? Is it normal to be off balance and not be told to keep taking the drug? So essentially what happened with that one, people were told in other countries to keep taking the drug even though they were having nausea, vomiting, becoming nutritionally deficient and probably thiamine deficient. So that is a preventable side effect. You give vitamin B1 if you detect thiamine levels are low. And now with some other JAK2 inhibitors, we're seeing that as well. So I think we can't push people too hard, and we have to be able to say, hold the dose reduce, come off the drug, there are other options. So what we like to do here is build other options and see what drives the disease in that person at that time. And that idea of personalized medicine or precision medicine, I think, is really, really important. Rizal Kurzrock is really a champion of this at the Cancer Center, as is Scott Lipman, our director, who really came in with this idea, start early, detect when the disease is taking a different road. So we were able to do that. So I've talked to you about one set of clinical trials that went all the way to phase three from having started with the idea here. So that was one thing that had to do with innovation. The next one was this weird pathway called the sonic hedgehog pathway. So the hedgehog pathway was discovered in the 70s in the UK, and they have hedgehogs there, those prickly things that kind of look like porcupines, but they're smaller. And so they noticed that larvae in Drosophila, when mutated, had mutated this hedgehog pathway. And then some scientists were playing too many video games, and they called it sonic hedgehog in mammals. So we were working on this pathway because we found it was activated in leukemia stem cells as a way for leukemia stem cells to clone themselves. Tanish Dareya was at Duke at the time, also working on it. We combined our data, primarily her data, actually, that was published in Nature in 2009. But we had the idea here, and actually, again, thanks to Ida, to work with a local company to really try and get that into the clinic, and that company was Pfizer. And this is together with CIRM funding as well. So the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine said, let's do something with this, because there was no plan to develop that drug at Pfizer or anywhere else at the time, actually. So anyway, we found that this hedgehog pathway downstream signaling target GLE2 was upregulated in blast crisis CML, that it told us that that was a leukemia stem cell, and that we could use that as a biomarker of response when we treated those humanized mouse models. That led to five clinical trials. Again, this is within 1 year of collaboration. So anybody that talks to you about the valley of death hasn't worked collaboratively. You know, you can go through the valley of death unless you have somebody else give you wings. Here we have the paragliders. We're used to people taking off with parachutes and fixed wing hang gliders and things. So we're actually used to people taking risks. They're calculated risks, but we do that together. So for us, you know, provided you could work collaboratively with our innovative colleagues with Ruben and Donna and other people that will help with our IP, it looks like we can bring things into the clinic fairly quickly. That's not a coincidence. This is because our patients are us. You know, we're all going to be patients. They're very, very motivated, not to just take a pill to get rid of the disease, but actually to be healthier lifestyle-wise. So they're more likely to ask the incisive questions that will keep them safe on a trial. So this was a very rewarding trial. You can see, so basically having expression of GLE2 was associated with a lower survival. So those folks were saying, hey, I want to sign up for this trial, which is a pill. Look at the average age. Look at some pretty fit 69-year-olds. They had to be fit, basically, to get on this trial. This is a pill. They were also the best responders. So never assume that people can't do something because of their age. We really go by motivation. You know, how motivated are you to be healthy? And so, you know, I have a couple in clinic that are in their 90s and they're wondering why they're tired. They have a personal trainer. Well, okay, let's get to the bottom of things. So we'll work with people. If they're really motivated, we'll include them on these trials. But the people who were older who had acute leukemia did the best. And actually, the clinical trial that's done the best results are in people who were older who transformed to acute leukemia. They've had the best responses. So those data were just presented at ASH by Jorge Cortez. It's very exciting because we haven't had an advance in acute myeloid leukemia in 40 years. So this may be something that's really clinically tractable. So that was case number two. Don't give up just because it looks hard. Work with your team and somehow you'll manage to make it work. The next target, again, funded in large part by the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, who really funds us to work on stem cell research, was ROR1. This is one that Donna's really helped with, ROR1. So this is a cell surface protein that's usually just expressed in the embryo during brain development and spinal cord development. And Tom Kipps and his lab found that it was expressed by 94% of people with chronic lymphocytic leukemia. And you think, well, CLL, you know, life expectancy is 11 to 20 years, but it's not curable. And actually, some people have more aggressive CLL, and those are the ones that really expressed high levels of ROR1. So we got to work with a CIRM grant to make an antibody targeting this particular cell surface marker, which gets growth factor signals from WNT5A to tell the cell, okay, you can survive now in this home. We did this entirely in-house. So this was something where we outsourced to companies, but all the decision making was made in-house by our team. So I think of it as the SWAT team approach. This is San Diego to me. You get a little team of really talented people and don't change the team. So what happens sometimes in large pharmaceutical companies is they change the team and they go, why didn't it work? Why didn't it move forward? Well, to me, that's like watching the Super Bowl. And then at halftime, they say, oh, we're going to change the stadium now. The whole team has to move over. Oh, and by the way, we're changing the quarterback. And that happens. You probably saw that at JP Morgan. Lots of mergers. They don't know, you know, where the ball is. Here, we tend to stick together. We're a community. We expect to be able to answer to the community. We tend to kind of keep the team similar. And if we're passing the ball, we tell them what the play is. So that's a little different. So we found that this antibody, which is originally called UC961, decreased CLL cells in a humanized mouse model, commensurate with doses of the antibody. This led to a clinical trial September 2014, 4 years after starting this project. 4 years. Not 10 to 15 years, not several billion dollars later. That's what we can do. I'm crowing about the accomplishments of our team here, not my accomplishments. It's all of us working together, and I think that's what's unique. We've done this clinical trial since September 2014. We've, thanks to Michael Choi, working extremely hard with Riley Kidwell and Tom Kipps, had 23 patients on this trial. We're trying to move this to the phase 1B, phase 2 setting for other lymphoproliferative disorders in collaboration with a company called Onterno. And it looks really good. So we're excited about that. There are other indications, and Donna again and Ruben are helping us with this, thank you, to see what other diseases to move this into. Breast cancer is an obvious one. There's Tom with the syringe from the first patient. We couldn't actually believe it. Because when you work that hard for, even though it was just a 4-year period, it was intense. So I'm not saying it wasn't a lot of work. It was a lot of work, but extremely rewarding. And that person's still doing well. So that was kind of cool. So those are the three things I wanted to talk to you in terms of discoveries that led to clinical trials where we didn't necessarily know where it was going, but we had a good idea it could be useful clinically, and we had enough support locally and from funding organizations, and most of all from patients to go ahead. The more difficult processes involved in cancer stem cell evolution involve RNA. So we talked about DNA mutations we can target, like the JAK2 mutation. But RNA is like the engineer. So if you think about the DNA as being the blueprint for your house, if you're trying to do a remodel, then you think that's not what the house looks like, actually. It looks quite different because the engineer may have interpreted it differently, saying there has to be a structural beam. The builders like the protein, the engineers like the RNA. Well, it turns out the engineer goes awry a lot in cancer stem cells, and we've been able to detect these activities very, very specifically using sequencing technology. RNA is sliced or spliced into pieces, and that's really what distinguishes us from lower life forms. So if you think of why would we make different versions of the same gene, why would we splice that gene differently? It's because we have to live or hope to live at least 80 years. Mice don't do that as much because they have to live 2. So their gene expression control is more like an on-off switch. Ours is like the thermostat in the room. You have to dial it up, dial it down. That's what splicing does. It dials up or down gene expression in response to environmental stimuli. So we found a missplicing event in leukemia in this gene that regulates cloning of the leukemia. That was heretical at the time. That was in 2008. People said, there are no splicing changes in cancer. We said, yes, there are. You just have to look at the right cell type. So that was published. Then we found that the pro-survival gene was upregulated by splicing. Then we said, well, maybe this is a general mechanism in cancer. And Frieda Holm in the lab started looking at a repressor of splicing that's normally there in stem cells and found that it was deregulated. And then finally we started to say, is it just splicing or are we actually doing that thing that drives me crazy on my iPhone? I don't know if you guys find this, but if I'm sending a text, sometimes it autocorrects. I say, that's not what I meant to say, and unfortunately I've already sent it. That's what happens in our cancer stem cells. They're autocorrecting, but they're not doing it properly. So that autocorrect or RNA editing is something that we found is actually a telltale marker of cancer. So we can find missplicing, we can find BCL2 isoform switching, and we can find this RNA editing. You can't find those in mice. So if you just looked at mouse models or fruit flies or zebrafish, you couldn't find this. This is really something that is based on our higher level capacity to alter our gene expression. And editing is based 90% of the time on these sequences that you probably learned, like I did, were junk DNA. They're called ALU sequences. So when I did my undergrad in genetics, the genetics professor would say, well, we all know we have junk DNA and it's useless. I said, but that's a lot of our genome. That's 10% of our genome. But there was one guy that said, I don't think it's useless. I think it's actually really important. And these ALU sequences, ALU sequences, may have a function. Well, he was way ahead of his time. This is in the early 90s. He actually kept working on these ALU sequences. Other people were saying, it's junk. Mike, forget about it. You're going to lose all your funding. Well, he did. He actually lost all his funding. Packing his lab into boxes. He was a rock star at the University of British Columbia, where I was doing my PhD. We really couldn't understand how he would lose funding, because he'd made all these seminal discoveries. Anyway, the next day, he woke up to a very early call. He'd won the Nobel Prize for psych-directed mutagenesis. That was Mike Smith. And he just said, well, I can't believe I lost my funding, because I was working on something that I thought was fundamentally important. Well, of course he was. He just understood that basic science really matters, and you have to delve deeply into how things work. And he was really willing to put in the work. Anyway, it turns out these ALU sequences that Mike was working on dictate whether or not we're going to edit correctly or incorrectly. Now, what happened with Mike was, I was a medical student, and I was in the BMT clinic just doing a rotation, and they said, you can't see the next patient because you know him. And, you know, he often commented on talks I would give in our Department of Microbiology, which is what my PhD's in, but be very tactful and not ask me tough questions and put me on the spot until after the lecture. Anyway, he developed myelodysplastic syndrome that evolved to acute myeloid leukemia, and at the time that was considered incurable. And what we found in the lab recently is part of what allows that evolution to occur is ALU-directed editing, exactly what Mike was working on and said really matters. So what happened after he died was Mark O'Mara took over the Michael Smith Genome Foundation. Actually, the Canadian government gave him an entire foundation. They gave him $50 million within a few days, saying, okay, we think it matters too. We think what you're working. And we still use site-directed mutagenesis in the lab. Faye has done this, Elisa has done this. So it's a very important technique to us. But for him, that was just a technique. He thought the ideas were more important. Anyway, so Mark O'Mara took over at the helm, and he discovered that this RNA editing enzyme, ADAR1, was the most upregulated gene in relapse of lobular breast cancer. So that was a Nature paper. That was kind of cool, but it was because he was remembering what Mike said. Look at the sequences between the genes. It's not just the genes, the coding sequence that matters. Sometimes the stuff in between, that so-called junk DNA, matters. So he was looking, he found it. We started looking at these RNA editing enzymes a couple of years ago. Fei Jiang really spearheaded this project. In humans, we have three, and we've really focused on this ADAR1. They're really supposed to be antiviral enzymes that are the sushi chefs to cut up these RNA viruses to protect our stem cells from being infected by viruses like HIV. So if you have HIV, this one gets turned on big time. It's supposed to be the sushi chef, as I mentioned, for HIV. But it can also change splicing, can change how the gene is read, and it can change the shape. So basically, it can lead to changes in how genes are expressed. So as I mentioned in the beginning, every time you think you have a good idea, somebody else is thinking about it at the same time, because you go to the same lectures. And you go, ah, I'm brilliant, I thought about this. So Faye and I were thinking, we're the only ones in the world that have thought about this or published it. No. Gordon Mills and Han Liang actually looked at 6,200 people, so over 6,000 people, 17 different tumor types, and found that this editing enzyme was wildly activated as the patients progressed. So they said, this is a really important biomarker of progression. And they did exactly what Mike Smith told us all to do, look between the genes, look in the parts that normally you wouldn't look at, the 3' untranslated regions, and these things in yellow here, the orange regions, the intronic regions, so between the genes. So that was kind of daunting. We're not the only ones with this idea, but our lab kept working really hard and again said, what do you do about it? This is the innovative process. How do you block that unbridled editing activity? How do you get it back to working properly? So Mariana Zepeto, Angela Cord, again, Faye, Leslie, many others in the lab. And again, you'll see Mark O'Mara here helped us a lot. This is with CIRM funding. We found that that same JAK2 inhibitor I mentioned in the beginning could actually dial down ADAR activity and prevent the cells from cloning themselves. When you combine that with a BCR-ABL inhibitor, it's really, really effective. You can basically turn off the tap. The other thing is, now we know we can detect this much more precisely thanks to Leslie Cruz developing this very specialized PCR technique called rescue PCR. And this is helping us with hit selection with our collaboration with GSK, which is the first of its kind in the UC system. It's the discovery partnership with academia, DPAC. So we're very excited about that. It's shared risk, shared royalties, making a drug together, doing the high throughput screen together, sharing assays. This is a little bit unique. We're the only ones in the UC system with that. There are about 10 of these around the world, DPACs. But they were really enamored with this technique, that we could use this for assessing a potential lead compound. But we can also use this in people to detect these editing events in just a few drops of blood. So the final quick story I just wanted to mention is I talked about editing. We also wanted to work a bit more on splicing to suggest that maybe genes aren't spliced properly in leukemia and that balance is upset as we age already. But of course, I thought aging is a bad thing, as Ruben was alluding to. What Leslie taught me by doing this project is aging, normal healthy aging is a good thing. So what we discovered here that was sort of surprising is normal hematopoietic stem cells, if they age properly, if they age in a healthy way, dial down these survival genes like BCL2. So if they get a mutation, they're not going to survive. So it's not so malignant. It's when the cells are trying to be too young, that's the problem. So that's what we discovered with this, which was, you know, sort of a nice eye-opener that healthy aging is a good thing, but also that we could target this together with Michael Burkhart's innovation, showing that there's a splicing modulator that was actually very effective at targeting leukemia as opposed to normal stem cells. So the reason we knew this is when we did RNA sequencing, this is with Kelly Frazier and a number of other people that were really involved in the making of bone marrow transplantation. Rainer Storr worked really closely with Donald Thomas to develop bone marrow transplants. We could see that there wasn't that much variation between young and old stem cells, but when you look at the progenitors, they're really different. And one of the patients that looked the youngest was an 82-year-old. So her progenitors looked the same as a young person. So clearly some people age at different rates. So that was kind of interesting. And we could detect aging better from a splicing standpoint than with any other marker. So we said, how different are young and aged stem cells or progenitors from their malignant counterparts? Really different. So even though when you look at them side by side, aged and young progenitors, they look kind of different, when you compare them to leukemia, they're totally on a different spectrum. So that was really good news, because that means we could really distinguish leukemia stem cells from their normal counterparts just based on splicing changes. And that was because the transcripts tend to undergo exon skipping and intron retention in leukemia, and they upregulate adhesion molecules to allow that homing process, CD44, P2K2B. So why does all that matter? It means we can monitor whether the splicing modulator is affecting leukemia stem cells more than normal stem cells, both in vitro, as we see here with Larissa Blaine in the lab, both survival and self-renewal are decreased with the splicing modulator, but also in reporter assays. So if a cell is splicing, then it'll stay green. If it's actually blocked in its splicing, it'll turn red. That's the process of intron retention. So we can watch that in real time. So we said, well, that's kind of interesting. This looks like a really targeted splicing modulator. And it just so happens that leukemia stem cells, because they're so reliant on splicing, are really sensitive to this. So we could see that in the spleen of mice, the bone marrow of mice, and the blood of mice that had been transplanted with leukemia stem cells. And they reverted to a normal splice isoform pattern that was more analogous to an aged normal, downregulated CD44. So that tells us that we might be able to modify this ramped up splicing that we see in leukemia. So that's a unique therapeutic vulnerability in cancer stem cells. This is being published by other groups in Nature for MYC-driven cancers that really rely on splicing, that this may have implications for a number of different cancers. We focused on leukemia stem cells, but we think that targeted splicing modulation may be really important for eradication of cancer stem cells. Now, those are all discoveries. You know, they have had some impact already on people that have rare diseases, but what about more common cancers, and how do we target cancer stem cells in more common cancers? I talked about small molecules like the JAK2 inhibitor, the hedgehog inhibitor. They're different because they target stem cell pathways that are not the standard, just target division. Biologics, I talked about the antibody targeting ROR1, but what about cell replacement? What about E. Donald Thomas, transplanting, just wiping out the diseased marrow, putting in normal marrow? Well, I think cell replacement has become quite a bit more refined, where we want to replace a very specific cell type. Let's replace a natural killer cell and get the natural killer cells targeting the cancer more. What about correction of genes in cells? Could we just use CRISPR technology to take out that mutation? What about Sangamo, TALEN technology, already being used clinically? That's not pie in the sky. It's already happening in HIV. And what about cell targeting, really going after these malignant cells with chimeric antigen receptor T cells? So these are all things that are happening clinically. These aren't future discussions. They're current discussions. It's just how much can we be involved in here so that our patients, who are ultimately ourselves, benefit. So this is not altruism. This is we're all going to have something, or our family members will. The challenges are target validation and potency testing. How do you know if it's actually hitting the target? These are relatively rare cells. So that involves academia with technology transfer and appropriate filing of intellectual property, working closely with industry, and having a clinical trials infrastructure. This matters economically. So what's the most common discussion I have with my patients? It's not, what's my prognosis, doc? It's, how much is this going to cost me, doc? Did you just say it was going to be $2,600 a month as a copay for this inhibitor? I mean, that's unconscionable. How can they be stuck with that kind of bill? Not only that, what about long-term side effects? People don't want to live with the idea that they might get Wernicke's encephalopathy someday or some other weird side effect. What about just an eradication strategy? Can we come up with strategies to eradicate the malignant clone that is at the root cause of cancer, these cancer stem cells, because it matters economically, not just on a grand scale because we have people going in and out of hospital with complications of chronic single-agent therapy, but because I think psychologically people need to know we can get rid of the bad seeds, because people can become demoralized if they're taking a pill or two every day for cancer. And I think we can do a slightly better job. So this idea that targeting cancer stem cells can have an economic impact has caught hold in the EU. So, you know, there are meetings in Heidelberg, as you pointed out, in Il Chioco in Italy. This is just gaining steam. It's not losing steam. Tokyo, we had the royal family there, the Princess Takamatsu meeting. This was in November, focusing entirely on cancer stem cell detection and eradication. So this is the prince, and this is the princess. So when we went up to meet them, we were able to shake their hands, and he couldn't speak in English because he's not allowed to, because he's a representative of the royal family, so he can only speak in Japanese. But he was a scientist, and he did some work in zebrafish. So he was actually very interested in the work we were doing, as was she. So these international collaborations have really fueled local collaborations. This isn't quite so local, because this is the Kyoto contingent. You can see there's Shinya Yamanaka, who won the Nobel Prize for discovering induced pluripotent stem cell technology in 2012. Right next to him is Roger Chen. So it was very sad when he died, but he instilled in us this sense that we can do it locally, because this is the place to innovate. I know I sound like a broken record, but I really think with this number of institutes working together, we can get there faster. We also have quite an amazing infrastructure. So you know, just to talk about the clinical infrastructure that fuels translation targeting cancer stem cells and regenerative medicine in general, we've got the Serum Alpha Stem Cell Clinic. There are basically three sites here, City of Hope, and UCLA and UC Irvine have combined their efforts. We're now a network, so we share clinical trials. We've got our Alpha Stem Cell Clinic activities here in the Jacobs Medical Center on a floor that Denny made possible. So Denny Sanford, whose name is on the building, said, put my money where your mouth is and go and get something done clinically. So he's always keeping us on track, together with Larry Goldstein, who directs Sanford Stem Cell Clinical Center, and Jennifer Braswell. We've been able to have activities as well in the Altman CTRI. So you notice all these have a name: Lisa Altman, John and Rebecca Moores, Denny Sanford. These are the people who have invested in our community and make sure we stay on track. And then the Sanford Calm facility. So how do we keep learning how to do this stuff? You know, we want to make it easier for other people. We had to do a lot of work to build the infrastructure. Basically, we've got a division of regenerative medicine now. We have symposia yearly. We've got discovery grants and CIRM grants that are very specific to regenerative medicine, this GSK partnership and NIH grants, as well as philanthropy. Department of Defense is getting very interested in how to understand how cancer prevents normal regeneration and how do you boost normal regeneration of tissues. And then we've recruited four faculty members, including myself. We're recruiting two more, and then have an open search, or a search that just closed on Friday. An incredible business officer, Michelle Ghani, together with really nice administrators. The Alpha Clinic has kind of taken off. So these are all projects that you think, oh, maybe it'll work. People keep pulling up their sleeves and getting things done. This has a lot to do with Betty Cabrera, who's our manager for the Alpha Stem Cell Clinic, and everybody else that works very closely together with her to do these stem cell regenerative trials, and then the network. So I think what you'll see with stem cell research is it goes beyond cancer. We were the first ones to get to the clinic with stem cell research in terms of showing that cancer stem cells could be eliminated, and so normal tissue regeneration could take over. But now there are stem cell cures being reported in the media you may hear about through the Alpha Clinic Network. So this young man here had a disease called chronic granulomatous disease, 1 in 1 million diagnosis. He had stem cell gene therapy and is essentially cured. This young girl had severe combined immunodeficiency, you know, that boy in the bubble disease. That was stem cell gene therapy. She's now got a working immune system. We don't know how long these cures will last, but these guys are pretty excited about having a chance at all. So that's actually thanks to one investigator, Don Cohn at UCLA. And he just had the right sense of perseverance. He started working on this 20 years ago. So he never gives up, but maybe he can teach the rest of us to do a little bit of the same. And our lab is very similar to this, so I'm very grateful to Wen and Phoebe and Elisa and Faye, who are in the audience here, and the other members of our lab who have worked exceptionally hard to get the discoveries from the bench to the bedside. We've had great collaborators, really interesting, thoughtful philanthropists working with us, and a lot of funding from different funding organizations so that we can dream. You know, this is from Lake Cuyamaca on the weekend. Just, you know, it's a place to have ideas and help other people formulate those. Anyway, that's it. Thank you very much.
So I am going to invite Catriona to take a seat.
Sure.
And I will invite all of you, unless Ruben wants to make an announcement. But I was going to say, if you want to ask any questions, we have some time for questions, and I will hand you the microphone so that you don't have to wander around. Okay, I'll get. Okay.
I'll be happy to pass around the microphone. Well, that was fantastic. Questions from the audience. Comments. I have a lot of questions. Maybe I'll get started, you know, because I'm so, you know, impressed by Catriona's presentation. And I want to thank her publicly for the many times that you mentioned the work that we do with your team, to support your team. And thank you for that. We try to do our best. But like you say, it's a collaborative effort to have the successes that you've had. And everybody here in this room, you know, contributes to that success. It's a community effort. So maybe just to get started, you talked about many different projects that you're working on. But if you wanted to highlight and shout out and share with this audience in general, what's the hottest, newest project where you're looking for someone to partner or you have an idea to take to the market, that you'll feel comfortable sharing with this audience? What would that be? What's the hottest, newest thing that you are looking to partner with?
Yeah, I think this is something that Faye just got a grant on, but it's that RNA editing gene called ADAR1, which is clearly on our radar, so ADAR's on our radar, edits the DNA editing gene called APOBEC. So APOBECs are also antiviral genes, but they introduce mutations into DNA. So if you look at 40% of lobular breast cancer, those mutations are introduced by APOBEC activation. So the question is, why does that happen? What kind of viral stimuli are doing this, or is it just inflammation that looks like a virus that's activating ADAR to edit APOBEC? So what that means is that the environment is triggering an RNA editor to edit the DNA editor. And I know that sounds completely backwards, because we normally think of DNA to RNA to protein. But what's happening here is RNA is dictating what DNA does. So that, to us, is extremely important. It means that you can either look for a virus or just say, hey, how do we deal with the downstream consequences? So we've looked for a virus together with a local company called Human Longevity, Inc. We're doing a large sequencing project with them on all of our patients who consent to have sequencing who have myeloproliferative neoplasms, because it's a very defined disease. But also, how many people take ADAR and activate APOBEC and introduce these DNA mutations? Because when we look at these mutations that occur with aging, a lot of them have APOBEC mutation patterns, meaning a C to T change. Now, that may sound very abstract, but the reason we're so excited about it is we can detect it and we could potentially target it.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. What does that mean in terms of treatment for those patients?
So in terms of treatment, I showed you that JAK2 inhibition can dial down ADAR activity, meaning that we may be able to reduce the mutation burden in people by coming in with a JAK2 inhibitor. Because JAK2 inhibition will prevent ADAR activation, which will prevent APOBEC potentially from causing DNA mutations. Those are all theories right now, not the JAK2 inhibiting ADAR, but the ADAR to APOBEC transition right now is a working hypothesis, right, Faye? Jane in the lab has cloned a couple of these APOBEX, but we're pretty excited by that, and the NIH seems to be too, because we just got a grant on that. But still definitely early in the process. Is this just something that matters for cancer? Can we use this in other diseases like HIV? I mentioned these are antiviral enzymes. Can we use these, our understanding of these enzymes, to basically shut down HIV in reservoir sites? So that grant's due tomorrow. just little things like that. But lots of exciting stuff. So that's what I'm most excited about right now, just because it's at that discovery or earlier stage.
Hi, nice to meet you. Matt Kruger. Over the years, obviously, the teams that you've assembled and worked with have been really critical to success. But also, what about the research tools that you implemented? I mean, over the years, there's been a lot of advancements in technology, and how has that impacted your research, and in what ways?
That's been really absolutely critical. You know, if you try and ski and you don't have good skis, it's going to be hard to do the double blacks. So these are double black kind of experiments. So you have to have ability, you have to have tenacity, and not exactly be fearless, but be willing to take a chance. But also you have to have investment from funding organizations. CIRM, California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, invested in us, but so did philanthropists. So they came in with capital expense funding for some of these fancier pieces of equipment. So if we didn't have the in vivo imaging system, we couldn't have done the non-invasive imaging to see if we were getting a response in real time. That turned out to be really, really important. We didn't have the nanoproteomics device called ProteinSimple or NanoPro to say, were we detecting that misplice? Was it real or just a transcript? That was another donor. They say, you need that? We'll give it to you. We needed to image stem cells to see how often are they going to sleep. We made a special imaging sensor for that, a reporter. Fucci 2BL, Gabriel Pineda made that in the lab. But we needed a confocal microscope that could image those cells in a tissue culture dish with the stroma, with a niche. Otherwise, stem cells die if they don't have their home, another donor. So, you know, I think what happens with our donors is they're business people. They're looking for ROI in the sense of they want discoveries that are going to go to the clinic. Even if they don't have direct recompense financially, they're looking for something innovative. And this is when they see our team from our, you know, tech transfer, our center of innovation here, they say, hey, stuff really happens here. You're not just talking about things. You've given three examples in 8 years of things that went from idea to the clinic. But every single one of those involved philanthropy. So they are... Office of Advancement is actually really important as well. And just making sure our community members know if they want to be involved in this, come and see us. Our lab's pretty open. We've got a pretty friendly crew that they work really hard. But you're exactly right. There were very specific pieces of technology. More interestingly, recently, in addition to the sequencing technology, it's just been talent. You know, having people that understand how to do the bioinformatics that would allow us to look at that editing and develop new tools to find it. So that's the developing new tools has been fun. Yeah, no problem.
Just to piggyback on that question, I understand the donor perspective. What about industry? Has there been a lot of industry participation in the work that you've done and some specific examples of some companies you've worked with?
Yeah, so it's been absolutely vital. You know, the industry academia collaborations here are extremely strong. It's not us versus them, it's us and us. We're one team, and I think that's kind of unique to San Diego. I haven't seen many places like that, and I've been in different places. So with the first one I mentioned, that was Targagen, local little company that could, decided to work with us, share information. That was kind of a risky thing to do, us academics. They trusted us because they said, hey, come on in, see what you think of the experiments, and they worked better together. Yeah. So we're still working with a company that came from that. Sanofi got involved in that project, so it became rather large. We started working with Pfizer. It's all about people. Don't think about the size of the company. Think about who the champion in the company is going to be, and this is what Ruben and Donna look for. This is what Ida does very, very carefully and specifically, Ida DeChaite. So I think it's finding the right partner really matters. So I think that's been essential. From Roar One, that had the funding partner was CIRM, C-I-R-M, California Institute for Regenerative Medicine. They said, okay, we know this is high risk, but potentially high gain, and we're going to keep you to a very tight timeline. And we're going to have clinical development advisory panel meetings. And we said, no, we don't want those. But they actually kept us on track so we could do that in a fairly short time frame, the 4 years. And now we've still got certain funding to do the clinical trial. So I think, you know, there are very specific funding opportunities that were higher level that allowed us to sustain the team. They made all the difference. If we'd had to switch out a member of the team, we wouldn't have managed to get to the finish line. More recently, I mentioned GSK. We've had so many collaborations with industry because they want to work with people that are willing to work with them. And, you know, we started a couple of companies. So you can start your company, you can have this incubator idea, you can have industry academia collaborations that go all the way from making a drug together or diagnostic together, or it's just a service agreement. But I think they're all really important because they get us places we never expected to be.
You mentioned also how important it is to identify the right people and help. It is people making decisions, not organizations. My background is with large organizations, Becton Dickinson, Merck, Meliport, you know, 50,000 employees and, you know, multi-billion dollars. And it's always the people who makes the decisions. Sometimes it's really not the science, and sometimes not even the right financial decisions. And some of you may know this, right? We had a visit from a large company, very famous company, that acquired one of our licensees and is in the process of acquiring them today. And in that conversation, 2-hour conversation this morning, you know, it just came to light. This person was talking to us about how prior programs have been decided on or off by one particular individual and how certain individual had tried to kill certain programs because they didn't like it, right? So a lot of personal decision-making, personal feelings going to making decisions about which drugs get to the market in corporations. So things change, and you got to keep on top of who are the people, and those are not the organizations, who are the people in those organizations who are going to make the difference that you're working with. You know, one of the things that you had in one of your slides is you had a list of, I think, almost all of the academic centers on the Mesa here that you interact with. And one of the initiatives that we are developing in the office is the San Diego Innovation Council, which is an organization that brings together all of the academic tech transfer offices of all of these centers that you listed. And we are going to come together to provide a platform to promote the San Diego region externally. Beyond San Diego, to investors and companies to come and work with all of you together. So that's something that we're promoting, and we're going to launch around Bio here in June in San Diego. More questions from the audience.
Can you explain if there's a lot of people that are banking cord blood now, and with the rapid increase in sequencing information, if you could foresee a time where you'd basically get a genetic diagnosis of a tumor type, or there'd be a finite amount of mutations that would give that particular indication?
Yeah, so I think when people bank cord blood, usually what they're thinking is that cord blood the stem cells in that cord blood could be used for the child if they develop leukemia. Unfortunately, usually the cord blood that's banked isn't enough. So as a transplanter, I was always reminded that you needed at least 2 million CD34 positive stem cells per kilogram to be able to do a transplant. So one cord blood, even if you empty the entire placenta, which is where the umbilical cord is, which is what we mean when we say cord blood, that is enough for a 50 kilogram person or somebody who weighs less. So usually it's not enough for a person. So the whole idea of cord blood banking is predicated first on not having mutations in that cord blood. So if you had a child who had leukemia within the first few years after birth, they probably had the mutation at birth. So Terry Genver and Mel Greaves in London showed that children who are born with ALA, when you look at the heel prick, you know, the blood that they take, had that mutation at birth, usually. So that means that cord blood probably has that mutation already. So that means it's probably not the best source of stem cells for that child. But can we learn something from banked cord blood? Yes, we can. We can learn about those inherited mutations or those mutations that occur. We can learn to expand cord blood. Can we take those cells and put them in a defined growth medium and make more of them? Can we clone them? Can we understand how we transplant them either alone in an expanded state or together with their own home, their niche? So there's some companies working on that. So I still think it's vital information. Sometimes you can combine cords, combine them from two different individuals, expand one cord like Fate Therapeutics is doing. GNF has also done that successfully. So we have local companies that do this for a living. So I think it's possible. It's just probably not going to be helpful in and of itself for that child. In terms of being a source of donor stem cells for an adult who may get a bone marrow disorder, again, it's probably not going to be enough. So it's better to donate to a bone marrow registry. It's always a tough decision because the baby's about to be born. You say, what do I do with these stem cells? So I think at the moment it's better to donate to a registry. So then they're available to everybody in the registry if they want to do a combined cord transplant. Yeah.
Hi. Since you are at the academic, doing a lot of translational studies, I would like to hear from you about disease models. What is relevant? For example, now we know that to study immuno-oncology model, you kind of need the immune system to be there. And also, now you're working on the RNA modulation. So do we require different kind of models?
I think those are great questions. I think we've learned a lot from mouse models, mouse transgenic models, where we try and build a system from scratch. But also, what we did that I didn't mention for the sirimtuzumab project is we actually humanized the immune system of the mouse. And the FDA really liked that. It was a bit of a pain to do that. Eva Hellstrom did that in the lab. But basically what we did was we transplanted the mice, back to your cord blood question, with cord blood that somebody had donated to our lab. Those cells grew up in the mouse, they made a human immune system, and then we transplanted the mouse with chronic lymphocytic leukemia cells that had been marked with a fluorescent marker called CFSE. We were able to distinguish the normal cord blood-derived immune components from the malignant ones. And so we showed that sirimtuzumab specifically targeted ROR1-positive cells. The FDA loved that. We said, okay, well, it was one of the things we did. We're glad you liked it. But you're exactly right. You have to humanize the immune system of the mouse if you really want to look in human immune systems before you get into people. It's harder to do that in larger animal models, I guess, but not impossible. There's a whole move to work on organoids, these three-dimensional structures that look like a colon or look like another tissue, you know, a taste bud or whatever. That has been pioneered by Hans Clavers, who really is very, very clever and has shown us that we can do three-dimensional structure design in tissue culture. So that's a huge advance because that looks at human tissues. What Calvin Kuo is doing at Stanford is he's adding the human immune system. So he's humanizing the immune system in those organoids to say, how do you model inflammatory bowel disease? Can you do that in a tissue culture dish? And then, of course, locally, Xu Chen and others, Shani Varghese, have really started to look at, can we make bioreactor systems, 3D printed matrices that will allow us to say, how do these cells work together in a three-dimensional structure? So we have organovo locally. They make three-dimensional printed matrices of liver. If we transplant that into a mouse, can we humanize the immune system of the mouse to see how do those immune cells get to that 3D printed matrix, and can we model that? So I think the models are getting pretty sophisticated. The only question is the answers will be different depending on the model system. So we can't be driven just by one model system. We have to get similar answers from different systems to know we're going in the right direction. With regard to RNA, in terms of modeling RNA changes, fortunately we have these amazing collaborations. So we can do this with human longevity to look at what's happening at the DNA level, what's happening at the RNA level, together with our colleagues in Vancouver, Mark O'Mara's group, and also Kelly Fraser has been really seminal in that. But how do you know when RNA is changing shape? You know, that turns out shape of RNA matters. So there, you know, we'll have to be able to visualize that somehow. Certainly there are ways to see how DNA shape changes. Bing Ren is one of the leaders in the world on that. Our local Bing Ren, how do we do that with RNA? So a lot of us are struggling with that right now. We're going to have to figure that out. It'll likely be an imaging technology that is being pioneered at Berkeley right now, but right now we're relying on reporters. And this was what was so important about what Jean Yeo is doing with RNA binding proteins, but also Tanish Darea, being able to visualize when these RNA binding proteins, like Musashi, go in and they bind in very specific cells, and she can see that in real time by imaging. So that's extremely clever. That's why she became an NCI Outstanding Investigator and has looked beyond leukemia into other cancers like pancreatic cancer and how do you target the RNA. There are people that have antisense oligonucleotide technology. Ionis used to be called ISIS, so they had to change their name. But they're
and
doing
she's
it.
Also here.
And she's here. I mean, I'm just talking about people here. We go together to these international meetings. That Princess Takamatsu meeting, you probably noticed David Cherish was in the picture. Mm-hmm. Tanish Darea is in the picture. This is the place you can do this tough stuff because people will let you. They won't say, oh, you didn't get that grant. You're kind of out the door. They say, okay, we'll support you until you get the next grant, until you get the next industry collaboration, when the next thing comes along, because sometimes your stuff is trendy and sometimes it's really not. So we have to be able to weather the storm and work together to do that. So that's why
follow up with one more question.
Yeah.
So so you have worked through multiple programs with the industry to get into the clinic, which was with very, very impressive timelines. So where do you see the biggest bottleneck for the late-stage development, and comment on the collaborations, where are they, or did you see hurdles somewhere?
I think the biggest hurdle is the high-hanging fruit. The low-hanging fruit is gone. You know, everybody wants the easiest, cheapest, lowest-hanging fruit. You got, I mean, it's gone. We've got to work on what I call the high-hanging fruit. So my husband and I were in South Africa on our own little safari in a Fiat Panda, just going around, seeing what we could see. And his brother got married there. He was an AIDS specialist. Anyway, we went off on our own, and we were underneath this tree that seemed to have some sort of weird fruit on it, and I heard some wild dogs barking. I wanted to see if I could see them, and I got out of the car. You're never supposed to get out of the car. I was out of the car, didn't have a guide. We're just looking, and then somehow through the bushes, this elephant came up right behind me, and it turned out I was underneath the marula tree. It's also called the elephant tree, which of course I didn't know at the time, but the marula fruit is what elephants love, and only they and giraffes can reach it. And basically this fruit ferments into something that tastes like Bailey's Irish cream. They love it, and you do not get between an elephant and their marula tree. So we had to jump right in the car and take off really quickly. But that's the kind of stuff we're going after, that marula tree. That marula fruit, it's high-hanging fruit, but extremely rewarding. That is not amenable to CRO, you know, contract research organization style of research, where they don't have the incredible depth of expertise, commitment, and equipment. You were asking about equipment. We have to have an incredible vivarium. We have to have incredible imaging, millions of dollars worth of imaging equipment. We have an 11 Tesla MRI magnet in this building. We're spoiled. We cannot do that in industry, in the startup companies that some of us have started, because we don't have that equipment. So I think the biggest barrier to translation right now is being able to get funded to do this work here to increase the valuation of the project so we can take it to phase one, and then maybe when we're at phase one, then pass it on to some bigger companies. Because usually what happens is people say, oh, no, no, that's too hard. Let's kill early because it'll never work. So our biggest impediment to progress is nihilism. It's cynicism. It's saying it's never going to work even before you've done it. So I think we've had a chance to have egg on our face a few times. I showed you the successes. I didn't show you the failures.
Very good. Oh, one couple of more questions, and then we'll wrap it up.
So this is an incredible initiative, the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, which is probably one of the first in the world, I guess. Yeah. That public money has been funneled for this purpose of scientific discovery and discovery of treatments and so on. So I wanted to know your thoughts, you and UCSD, now that it is coming to the end of the term of that CIRM,
right,
and what kind of mobilization and what kind of activities are there, which I do not know whether there is initiative to actually get a second round of public funding or any thoughts on that?
Yeah,
because
I think
money, as you said, is so critical for each and every aspect.
It's absolutely critical. Money to do these experiments properly, to go after the high-hanging fruit, and to be able to maintain our teams, whether really talented, we need to pay them properly. CIRM, is, I think there's a movement afoot to plan for the next proposition, which would be precision regenerative medicine oriented, so stem cells and genomics. 2018, $5 billion. I think that's the movement. I think it really helps to have wins in the clinic, obviously. So we have 27 clinical trials in the Alpha Clinic Network. Quite a few of these are first in human. Other people in the world said, we can't believe you did 3 first in human trials in one center in 1 month. ROAR1, neural stem for spinal cord injury, and Viacyte for diabetes. We just didn't know any better. We just did it with funding from Denny and CIRM. So, and of course, the company is saying, yes, we can, yes, we can, that whole attitude. I think it's really important to have a state funding organization for science. I think in this state, where we have the level of innovation that we have and a certain culture to get things done very quickly, we need a state funding agency that's very responsive, and I think that's why it's been so effective, because they're directly responsive to the voters of California. So I think it's a very good funding opportunity. I hope that it gets renewed. I think even if it doesn't, by 2020, when the funding runs out or the last grants go out, we're going to be sustainable because we're doing so many trials or planning to do so many trials with various companies that have come here because then they see, oh, there's the right investment infrastructure. There's the right tech transfer kind of mentality. You know, there's the right partnership opportunity. So that's what we've been crushed by in the Alpha Clinic lately. All these companies coming from not just other parts of the U.S., but other countries trying to have companies here who really want to get started in trials.
And, of course, the hope is that as these agents come to complete their clinical trials, that they will then be on the market, and CIRM will get money back from sales of that. So that's one of the conditions of a CIRM grant, is that when this finally gets commercialized, some of the profits go back to CIRM to help them to replenish their supplies so that they can give more grants out to do more studies, to do more more work. So, I mean, it's going to be self-sustaining, but we obviously don't want them to run out of money anytime soon. And they do have a sufficient amount of money for the short term.
I think this year it's going to be $210 million spent by CIRM on clinical trials development. So they've also provided funding, non-dilutive capital for companies that are interested in taking on CIRM funding in sort of a loan repayment program strategy. So that's a little bit innovative, a little different, I think.
One last question. From the materials you covered today, which item do you feel would come to fruition first in terms of being in routine practice, and how long might that take?
In terms of approval? Probably in terms of FDA approval, I think that JAK2 inhibitor, if we get that off clinical hold, so that'll be the first one that I think will be in general clinical practice in terms of actual FDA approval. Hedgehog inhibition, I think, will be another year. That one will likely go for orphan drug status for AML. With the ROAR1, that's going to take us another couple of years, I would say. It's hard to predict. You know, we've done the phase one trial, just about finished that, but you never know how phase two and phase three are going to go. CAR T-cell therapy, you know, that's something that the chimeric antigen receptor T-cells that target very specific cell surface markers, that is likely to get approval in the next year or two. I think some of these things that started as technologies to really develop stem cells ended up being useful for something entirely different, because we learned how to use, people learned how to use the technology and put it to test earlier. But I think that the most important application of the technologies that have been developed for stem cell research so far have actually involved diagnostics. Really understanding, because with stem cell research, we had to be able to sequence in a very small number of cells. Well, it turns out you can use the same sequencing technology to decide if somebody inherited this problem, and that's what we're doing in the clinic now. We're taking a few cells from the saliva, just a little bit of spit, we can find out what you inherited. A little bit of blood, we can find out what you acquired. And I think that's a real advantage, knowing where we are in terms of a stem cell fitness report, where we are in terms of disease stratification or prognostication, where are we going on our trajectory of illness, and can we turn back the clock on that? So what we've learned as lessons is we can turn back the clock on some of these things, provided we find them early enough. And that's been the really exciting piece, and something I think that we're known for here as a community. You have Illumina, you know, JCVI, HLI, all these sequencing technologies are made here. You know, that Qualcomm, you know, all the stuff that goes in your phone, being able to assess whether the patient's doing okay remotely and not having to be by their bedside in the ICU at all times. That's San Diego-driven technology. So that's the kind of stuff we kind of take for granted, but is considered a big deal in other parts of the world.
So one of the things that I would like to say is you had made a statement during your talk that basic science really matters. And that really resonates with me, especially in all the other things you said. So just in conclusion, I want to say, yes, basic science really matters. And not only are you and your lab doing basic science, but you've taken it the next step, and you're translating it, and you're in the clinic. And we thank you so much for presenting today.
Thank you so much, Donna, Ruben, everyone here.